You have done what you could do. Some blunders and absurdities no doubt crept in. Forget them as soon as you can. Tomorrow is a new day. Begin it well and serenely and with too high a spirit to be encumbered with your old nonsense. All right. Welcome to flight 2022. We are prepared to take off into the new year. Make sure that your goals and intentions are secure and locked in an upright position. All self-destructive habits and devices should be turned off and put away at this time. Should we lose altitude under pressure during our flight, reach up and hold out a prayer. Prayers will automatically be activated by faith. Once your faith is fully activated, you can assist other passengers. There will be no baggage on this flight. We repeat, there will be no baggage on this flight. The captain has cleared us for takeoff. Destination greatness and more. Enjoy flight 2022. It's going to be a grand ride. Yes, it is. So now on your different card, on one side at the top, write 2022. You know, Emma Curtis Hopkins said, there's good for me and I ought to have it. That's been one of my favorite statements for so long. I have to remind myself of that sometimes. There's good for me and I ought to have it. So what are you inviting in this coming year? What would you love? What do you want? And where are you going? So at the top of the card, I want you to write under the 2022, I am so happy and grateful. Now that I and begin to fill in as if it is already here. I am so happy and grateful now that I, maybe it's you're inviting something in the area of health or finances or relationship or career. What do you want? What are you claiming right now? So happy and grateful now that I... What do you want? What would you love? Breathe into it. And remember, you don't have to know how to make this happen. You're making it welcome. That's the basic law of attraction. You're making it welcome. All right? Breath with that, just finish it up. And then I want you to look at what you wrote and encapsulate it into one word, which would be your power word for 2022, for you. What's one word that would encapsulate all of this? And usually it's it's whatever word you want. Could be success, abundance, prosperity, peace, love, joy, whatever word is your power word. You're gonna write it on the back side of the card. So write your power word in big letters. Just one word. And then you're going to put squiggly lines around the word, just squiggly lines around your word. And this is just for you. You get to take this home. And think about this word and the squiggly lines. You're planting a seed into the field of unlimited possibilities right now. You are an attractor to whatever it is you wrote inside the squiggly lines. And I want you to think about, what would this feel like to you? Just close your eyes for a moment. What would this feel like? How would you stand? How would you be? How would you speak? What would it look like? What would it feel like when you claim this for yourself for this coming year? Just visualize it in your mind. Make it up. Use your imagination. As I've mentioned before, Albert Einstein told young children, they said, "How can we get as smart as you?" He said, "Read fairy tales." "Well, how can we be smarter than you?" "Read more fairy tales." Imagination. So imagine this already happening. How does it feel? And there it is. Bravo. So you can put that in your pocket, bless it. And Amada's going to lead us in our sacred reading to ground us even more.
Today, I stand at the door of the abundant life and I knock. All that I seek opens to me and beckons me to life's fullness. I enter my divine heritage and walk with the great and the true, based on spirit and motivated by love. And so, and it is so. So read with me this time. Today, I stand at the door of the abundant life and I knock. All that I seek opens to me and beckons me to life's fullness. I enter my divine heritage and walk with the great and the true. Ahead of me is the royal road to good living, based on spirit and motivated by love. And it is so.
Do your work.
So my talk today is welcoming new friends and new light. As I mentioned at the beginning in my welcome, all the celebrations of life that are happening are going to happen. And the monthly theme in the Centers for Spiritual Living has been the journey of becoming. We got to experience bringing in light and intentions through the meditation we just did, making room for our good. And I would like to propose that we share and expand that good to include others. The Centers for Spiritual Living has a global evolutionary vision that I'd like to share with you. We envision a world in which we live and grow as one global family that respects and honors the interconnectedness of all life. A world where this kinship with all life prospers and connects through the guidance of spiritual wisdom and experience. I welcome new friends and shine my light. I invite you to say that with me. I welcome new friends and shine my light. Hey, neighbor, look around and smile at all the people in the room. They're your neighbors. Hey, neighbor. Yeah. Hey, neighbor on Facebook. I recently completed a ministerial class on diversity, inclusion, and oneness. And I was reminded of the unique contribution that we each have to the world. And that we each have that special spark that no one else has, that's waiting to shine, just in case you haven't lit it yet. And just like a stained glass window, and we also have one back there, if you've ever seen it, at the back of church. But a stained glass window, each piece of glass is needed to make it beautiful. The same way each person in our community is needed and important. Just like in a stained glass window, each piece of glass is beautiful. And it's needed to make it beautiful. So when the light shines through a stained glass window, it illuminates everything in an array of color and light. We, our community, is like a stained glass window. And as a spiritual leader who is open to co-creating an inclusive spiritual community, two important identities for me in the discussion of diversity, inclusion, and oneness are: what do I stand on, and what do I stand for? Ernest Holmes said, who's the founder of Science of Mind, behind all is a unity, through all is a diversity, saturating all is a divinity. What do I stand on? I stand on my foundation of faith and the principle of unity with my connection to Source, to God, the God of my understanding. What about you? What do you stand on? What do I stand for? Well, that reflects my values and ethics by which I live. It gives me a direction to stay true to what I stand on. What do you stand for? Author Mark Nepo says, a paradox of human existence is in this question. If love and truth are in us, part of our inheritance, why are they so hard to find and grow in another? He says, maybe love and truth are like seeds within us that need watering and attention. And if I water them, the Spirit of God can expand my heart and my understanding of others. The river of who we are, he says, runs through every country. It ignores all borders. Our call is to follow that river. I love that image. Are you willing to plant a new seed and notice any old beliefs that may stand in the way of what you stand on and stand for? Or are you trapped in your own stubbornness? Has anybody ever been stubborn? No. Not here. Not you. Not now. That's why we come to spiritual community, to recognize when we need to maybe shift an attitude or a thought, right? So are you ready to stay awake and aware?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you. A few of you are. Are you ready to be kind, forgiving, and loving this year?
Yes.
Yeah. Kindness. That word has been really quite prevalent in many many things out in social media. Just be kind. And we talked about spiritual courtesy a couple weeks ago, or a couple months ago when I spoke. Manners are spiritual manners. So Ernest Holmes says, as we evolve spiritually, as we evolve spiritually, the whole human family benefits. Hear that. As you, individuals, evolve spiritually, the whole human family benefits. Wow. That's powerful to me. I welcome new friends and shine my light. Can you say that with me again?
I welcome new friends and shine my light.
So one of the things we studied in this class, and I'm going to just share this briefly, is these cycles of the cycle of socialization, liberation, and spirituality. And the idea is that we're all born into a specific set of social identities. Where we grew up, the religious upbringing we had, were you middle class, lower class, upper class, no class, did your father work, did you have parents, all of that stuff. All of these things create a way of us sometimes thinking and being in the world until we outgrow them, until we realize that, oh, I have some hidden prejudices or biases because of my upbringing. But is that what I believe today? So we have then, we move into a cycle of what's called liberation, where we can start to question, oh, do I believe that now? And so we can use tools to begin to dismantle old beliefs that we carry and help build a community where everyone is involved for the greater good of all. And we can create a change for the better. So as we wake up spiritually and mentally, we can start to notice when there's discrepancies in terms of respect to others or incidents that create something that just doesn't feel right. And do we have the ability to say something or to step in, to just notice those things? Because once we know something, we can't not know it anymore. I've said that before. We have subconscious beliefs, we know this, about differences, and it can come to the surface really quickly when we encounter people that are different from us. People that look different, that talk different, that behave differently. So we often can reflect hidden beliefs in our interactions with strangers. Think about it. How do you respond to someone who has a lot of tattoos, or a lot of piercing in their head? Or do you have fear when a person of color or a homeless person approaches you? Just to notice those things. To notice what we're holding in or not willing to let out. So I'm encouraged to invite all of us as a faith-based community to just become more mindful of our hidden beliefs, prejudices, and biases, and be willing to change them if necessary, to create that world that works for everyone. Are you willing?
Yes.
Yes.
Just to even think about it. Because then we move into the cycle of spirituality, and that moves us from the obvious place of separation into a place of connection and belief in a higher power. It moves us from exclusion to inclusion to oneness. It moves us from me to we. Michael Beckwith said, You are the unique, divine, perfect, unrepeatable way that God and life expresses. So act like it. As you live from this consciousness, you manifest joyous possibilities and unified conditions into existence. It is through right thought and belief that you greatly influence your environment. Know this, and release the weapons of mass distraction from your life. Have you ever been distracted? And live your divinity now. It is a good use of our divine humanity to learn from the past, to be present, and to move forward for the future in a creative way. I welcome new friends, and I shine my light. I welcome new friends, and I shine my light. So we're going to have story hour. Well, it's not really an hour. Don't worry. This is one of my favorite books that was in our children's bookstore, children's center. And it's called It's Okay to Be Different. And you can come closer if you'd like to. You want to see the pictures. It's Okay to Be Different by Todd Carr. It's okay to be missing a tooth, or two, or three. It's okay to need some help. It's okay to have a different nose. It's okay to be a different color. It's okay to have no hair. It's okay to have big ears. It's okay to have wheels. It's okay to be small, medium, large, and extra large. It's okay to wear glasses. It's okay to talk about your feelings. It's okay to eat macaroni and cheese in the bathtub. It's okay to say no to bad things. It's okay to come from a different place. It's okay to be embarrassed. It's okay to come in last. It's okay to dance by yourself. It's okay to have a pet worm. It's okay to be proud of yourself. It's okay to have different moms. And it's okay to have different dads. It's okay to be adopted. It's okay to have an invisible friend. It's okay to do something nice for someone. It's okay to lose your mittens. It's okay to get mad. It's okay to do something nice for yourself. It's okay to help a squirrel collect nuts. It's okay to have different kinds of friends. It's okay to make a wish. It's okay to be different. You are special and important just because of being who you are. Love, Tom. The end. It's okay to be different. We all have something we're different. That makes us different. And I want us to share that today. I made an empty heart there that we're going to fill in with different things from each of you that makes you unique. You know, often when we talk about diversity, we think of racial diversity. And as we know in Auburn, we don't really have that here. It's just not the way our community's made up. But I realized that we have a lot of diversity among you all and on Facebook of many things that makes us different from each other. And so we're going to share that. Ahmad is going to, well, first of all, I'm going to tell you the four things. And Ahmad is going to walk around, and you're going to answer the four questions, and I will write them up on the board. What city and state did you grow up in? What religion or faith were you brought up in? What is your cultural heritage or your ethnicity? And what makes you different? What's something about you that maybe nobody else knows about? So I'll start. I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri. And I was a good Catholic girl. I'm still a good girl. And my heritage culture is Irish and English. And what makes me different is, I'm the youngest of seven kids. Wow. All right. Go ahead, Amada. So where were you born or raised?
I was born in Oroville, California. And I attended the Baptist Church with one girlfriend, and on the alternate Sundays, I attended the Mormon Church with my other girlfriend.